Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. This past year, my in-laws and myself celebrated the 4th of July in Granville, Michigan. And we celebrated by going to the parade that they were hosting there, a special parade, because I remember having to wait an incredibly long period of time because it was hot. We had to wait because, well, Vice President Pence was going to walk in the parade that day, and we had to wait until he arrived. And that was kind of neat for the people that were walking in the parade and sitting on the side to see. Unfortunately, though, myself and my wife and the other in-laws that were not walking in the parade didn't get to see him because, well, we were at the very end of the route. We saw all the added security, we saw the police presence, we saw the snipers and the extra spotters on the roof. We even saw the security detail that was protecting his SUV. But by the time that Vice President Pence got to where we were in the parade, all we saw was his SUV with the rear driver's side window rolled down just slightly with a female hand outside going like this. And what looked like the glimpse of a white-haired man sitting right next to her. Now, that's pretty understandable, right? I mean, after all, he's the Vice President of the United States. He's the number two guy in charge. If the president dies, he's got to take over. So we would expect that. We would expect the added security. We would expect that from a leader of a nation. But that's not how Jesus was traveling in our text for this morning. You would think that as the king, he would have even more protection than the vice president of some young 200-year-old nation. That his entrance would be far more grand and flashy. But it wasn't. And the reason for that is because Jesus is our humble king. And our king is like no other. Well, for 3 years, Jesus had been traveling the countryside of Judea. He had been performing such wonderful things. He had caused the demons to flee from many individuals. He had cured the sick. He had made the lame walk, the deaf hear, the mute speak, and the blind to see. He had performed miraculous wonders, like changing the material composition of water into wine, by making the uncontrollable bleeding of a woman cease, storms to be silent. And he even walked on the liquidy surface of a lake as though it was a concrete road. Jesus had been called many things. Teacher, Christ, Son of Man, Son of God, some of them not so good, blasphemer, child of the devil. He'd been called many, many things. And as he was approaching the gateway to Jerusalem, he knew what awaited him on the other side, but he was still willing to go, because our king isn't like anyone else. Mark tells us that as they were approaching the Mount of Olives, there were two towns that were near there. One was called Bethany, the home of Lazarus. The other was Bethphage. And Jesus decides to send two of his disciples on a special mission. Now, we don't know what town was directly before them, but what we do know is what their purpose was there. And what Jesus' purpose was, to show that his kingship was unlike any other. He told them that as they were to go into the town, they were to enter it and find a colt that was tied up there. Now, from the descriptions of the other gospels, we know that that type of colt was a donkey, a young donkey. But does that really sound like the type of ride that the Savior of the world would be riding on? I mean, shouldn't he have been like on this majestic, mighty war horse or a giant elephant? Or at the very least, like this majestic, glittery cart. A chariot. But that's not it at all. And why is that? Well, the prophet Zechariah tells us. He says this. He says, "Rejoice, your king is coming to you, riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Jesus wasn't like any other king. He wasn't just a son of David. He wasn't just a king. He was the king. The messianic king that Zechariah proclaimed. And Jesus proved himself to be by riding on a beast of burden. But Jesus doesn't just tell them what type of animal that they were looking for. He tells them the specific animal that they were supposed to find. And he says this. He says, "One which no one has ever sat." And why does that matter? Well, God in his word tells us that for specific animals in which no one has ever ridden on, they were to be set aside for a special, honorable, and holy purpose. No matter if that purpose was for atoning sins, whether it was for carrying the Ark of the Covenant, or whether it was for purification rites, they were to be set aside for a holy purpose. And could there be any holier purpose than to carry the Son of God who came into the world to save, who was coming to issue in his reigning activity in people's hearts? This evidence alone verifies that Jesus is like no other king. But look at what the disciples react to with him. He tells them, as you go into this town, if someone asks you, "What are you doing?" this is what you are to say. And they listen. In fact, they go into this near town, they find the exact animal that Jesus wants, they untie it, and some men who are standing there, the owner, says, "What are you doing?" And they tell him the exact thing that Jesus said. "The Lord needs it." Now, the man could have said, "I don't care," or "No," or "It's mine," but he did. He understood who that Lord was, and the man let them go. What a test of faith, right? For the disciples. They have no idea what to expect going in there. They just have some of Jesus' words, but they go in, and it's exactly as Jesus told them it would be. But this test of faith was no greater than what they experienced before. It was no greater than him telling them to leave behind their family and friends and follow him. It was no greater a test of faith than for his disciples to have to feed multitudes of people with just a handful of basic ingredients. Nor was it a greater test of faith when he said that those who want to save their life will lose it, but those who lose their life for his sake will find it. It all comes down to confidence, commitment, and trust. Campaign managers and volunteers of political candidates devote hours, days, weeks, months, sometimes even years, assisting a candidate that they want to see elected. Now, the reason for that varies. For some, it's because they want the recognition. For others, they're using it as a platform for political career advancement. Yet there are some who do it because they honestly believe in that candidate, in his or her agenda. Yet I wonder, how many of them would be committed to that particular candidate if they knew that that candidate wasn't who they portrayed themselves to be? Perhaps some might, but what about if that candidate was going to lose the race? And they were going to do so on purpose. That's what Jesus has been talking about his 3 years. The end result of his 3-year campaign. Jesus carried them along for these 3 years, and that the hype and excitement of this day was carrying them to this particular moment to feed what they believed about their king. But the events would soon change. Because one of those disciples would leave him with greed in his heart and deception and betrayal on his lips. And the others would fail to heed their king's instructions to stay awake and listen. And what about us? When is it the most hard for us to listen to our king's instructions? Perhaps we can go with the easiest answer. Well, when things are going so awful in my life, that's when it's the hardest to listen. Because that's when it's hard to trust him. That's when it's hard to see the purpose he has in allowing these things to occur in our life and to understand what it is. But that's not the only time it's difficult. What about when things are going well? When things are going well, but yet he leads us to a difficult position where we are uncomfortable with what he's asking us to do. Or when we can't understand what is his point in allowing us to be in this particular spot at this particular time, and we try to make it fit our understanding. What are we to do in those situations? Are we to trust in ourselves? Are we to trust in our own understandings? Or are we to trust in our own expectations? Or our own desired outcomes? Or do we just listen to our Savior's words and carry it out? The thing is that Jesus, who told those two disciples to go into that town, knew that that colt would be there. And if he knew that that colt would be there, then he knew what would wait on the other side of that parade route that he was on just a few short days later. As the people saw him, they adored him. Not because of the colt that he claimed, but because he claimed them. And the same King Jesus that claimed them is the same King Jesus that claims us and inspires us to do the same that they did. Listen what they did. They threw their garments on the colt. People spread their garments on the road. Others spread branches. Those who went in front of the parade and those who were following cried out, "Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Friends, Jesus claimed us. He claimed us from the moment that he saw us from eternity. He claimed us as he went down that difficult, impossible road that any of us could ever think of going down, that would bring about our downfall, or his downfall, and our redemption. He claimed us through his word, not as a mighty warrior, but as a humble king. Jesus' campaign wasn't won by popular opinion or by majority vote. And the destination for him wasn't a winner's circle or the Oval Office, but a cross. our king was willing to go down that road because of his determination to exchange his crown of gold for a crown of thorns. To exchange that title of king for that title of servant and curse. To exchange the wealth of heaven for a treasury of pain and sorrow and sadness and death. To exchange the praise of heaven for the scorn of the earth. He did this because he was willing to do it for us. Friends, that colt that Jesus rode on may have borne the Savior of the world, but the Lamb of God bore the weight of our sins upon his body to secure our salvation with him. Every year we get to celebrate this wonderful and momentous day. And for what purpose? To celebrate a humble king who rode in on a donkey 2,000 years ago? Yes. But also to proclaim his coming again. We get to cry out and shout out, Hosanna, save us! But we have the confidence that he has. And he will do so again because our king is coming. Not in meekness, not in weakness, but in power. Not in humility, but in glory. Not riding a donkey, but riding a white steed. With a double-edged sword in his hand, and with you and me and all believers, past, present, and future, following behind him on the train of his robes to lead us home. Friends, our king is like no other. Because our king didn't march in a parade with security on all sides that were willing to lay down their life for his. No, our king marched and processed that road that led to Calvary to lay down his life for all of us. And because of that, our trust is in the right place. Our king, who has no equal. Amen. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guards our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.